Well, good to see you today, everyone, and welcome to our third week of Monsters in the Bible, where we're exploring the scary stuff in Scripture and trying to find meaning in it. And today we are reading a story, as we just heard, a story about Jesus releasing someone from demons and trying to figure out what that means for our lives. But first, let me digress for a minute. So I grew up in Southern California in the 90s, and in my teens and early 20s, I was told a number of times that I looked the way people imagined a quintessential surfer looked. At that time, I had longer blonde hair, and I, you know, dressed the way people my age dress, kind of a t-shirt and baggy shorts and sandals. And yeah, like I said, people would say, you would think I'm a surfer. And I remember one time, my wife, Stephanie, and I, we were on the road, and we stopped at a light, and this car pulled up next to us. And this random guy, I think he was a tourist with his family, sticks his head out and looks at me and says, "Hey, are you a surfer, man?" And for a split second, I think to myself, by the way, I'm not a surfer, but for a split second, I think to myself, should I tell him the truth or should I give him a thrill? And maybe it wasn't the right thing to do, but I decided I'd give him a thrill. So I stuck my head out the window and I put on my thickest over-the-top California accent. I said, "Yeah, man, surfer dudes." And he looked at his family member and went, "Yeah!" And then they went on their way. But like I said, the thing about it is I'm not a surfer, not at all. I've never been on a surfboard. I like the water. I like the ocean. But I'll have to tell you that to a certain extent, I find the ocean kind of scary because it is big. When you're in there, and if you ever meet the wrong wave, you discover very quickly how big the ocean is, how little control you have in it, and how it's bigger and stronger than you are. I remember a time when I went with my friends to the ocean, and you know, like I said, I never surfed, but there's these things called bodyboards, or some people call them boogie boards. One of my friends had one. I hadn't done it a whole lot, but I thought, okay, I'll take a spin out on the water. So I paddled out, got past the initial waves, and I was waiting kind of behind those front waves for one that would carry me in. And so I probably splashed around for like 10 minutes or so, didn't really have much success of riding away back in, and eventually I was getting tired. So I turned my bodyboard around, and I start kicking and kicking, getting my way back to shore. And I'm kicking, I'm paddling, I'm swimming, and I realize eventually that, you know, I'm not going as fast as I thought I should, but, you know, maybe I'm just not very good at this, so I just keep kicking and kicking. And after a while, I see this guy also on a bodyboard, all dressed in black, and he's moving along, and, you know, unlike me, he looks like he knows what he's doing in the water, and he's paddling very quickly, and I think to myself, you know, pretty oblivious, man, that guy really wants to catch a wave quickly. All right, well, here he comes, and he's coming, and I notice he's getting really close to me, and it still hadn't dawned on me. And eventually he gets right next to me and he says, "Hi, I'm a lifeguard and you're caught in a riptide." And it was like, oh my gosh. And in case you don't remember what a riptide is, riptides are the kind of waves that don't carry you in. They pull you out to sea. And so, you know, that was a freaky thing to hear. I was pretty scared. But he explained to me something I remembered later, that my parents had told me, that if you're ever caught in a riptide, you don't want to try to swim right in against it, because it'll just keep on pushing you back over and over again, which is exactly what was happening. What you have to do is you have to turn horizontal along the shoreline and paddle in that way until you exit where the riptide is, and then you can paddle yourself in. And so that's what we did. He kind of latched his bodyboard onto mine, and we made our way horizontally, and then we're able to get back to shore. And thank God for that lifeguard, or I might not be here today. But, you know, I share that story because this is a physical example of something that many of us at some point experience, probably just about all of us, which is a destructive power in our lives that is bigger than we are. And that is exactly the kind of thing that we're encountering in today's story, in today's gospel reading. In this case, the story describes what it seems to be a literal possession of demons. And whatever this thing is, what we can say is that it's destroying this poor man's life. It's dehumanizing. You know, it's taking away the joys of being human in his life. And the story describes what his life is like in very dramatic terms. It says this possessed man wears no clothes. It says says he lives among the tombs of the dead. It says he's unable to participate in normal human relationships. And the community doesn't know what to do with him. You know, he's just howling and making a mess and being crazy. And so they chain him to the tombs or to whatever. But he keeps on breaking free and going back to this place where there's no life, this place of tombs. So how do we understand this portion of the story? Well, you know, there are different perspectives, all of them that have a certain amount of merit. I was listening recently to a fellow who's a Christian, but also a clinical psychologist. And he does a lot of work doing ministry in the prisons. And he spoke about, from his educated standpoint, when he first went into that work, when he first started working with these guys, you know, he kind of took that educated psychological perspective of, you know, when people talk about their demons, it's just sort of an outdated way of talking about the things that they're struggling with, you know, addictions or mental illness or emotional issues. But he said as he continued his work in the prisons, he began to see how powerfully real the language of demons was for many of these inmates, whether they were saying it literally or not. You know, that, you know, having personal demons was very real for them. And for many of them, life really did feel like this internal struggle between good and evil, between God and things that wanted to pull them away from God. And he said he found himself starting to use that language because it just connected so well with their lived experience. So you hear stuff like that, and sometimes you'll hear other stories, and it can make you kind of rethink, you know, the reality. And is there some sort of spiritual evil? Who knows? And then, you know, you read, you come to other people, otherwise Christians, otherwise people, and they remind us of something else. On the other hand, you know, there was this guy I was listening to who talked about how much our knowledge of the world has grown and changed and improved over the centuries. In that centuries past, there were many things that we simply didn't understand as people. You know, for instance, the idea of germs, the idea that when you're sick, it is caused by germs and not an evil spirit, or not that you need to be bled a little or whatever. That's only been with us since the late 1800s. Even your best doctors until then didn't know that germs existed because you couldn't see them. You know, the idea that people might have disabilities or mental illness, that's a new idea too. You know, in the past, you know, before about 100 years ago, they just called people with those kinds of things people with bad character. Or even worse, they would say they're possessed with a demon. And then you read Bible stories like this, and you read about people who are trapped in destructive patterns of behavior that they don't want to do, but they somehow can't stop doing. They somehow can't overcome them. And at some point, it starts to kind of feel like the language they're using in the Bible kind of sounds like things that we in modern day call mental illness or addiction. So that's all to say that there are different ways to understand what's going on in a story like this. Different answers we can cling to. And at the end of the day, I'm not here to tell you what the answer is. I think I've done this every week. I hedge my bets. I don't know what was going on exactly in this story and in other stories like it. But I think what we can say is what we said a second ago, that this is describing a scenario where someone's overcome by destructive powers in their life. And again, this is very real to us. Many of us experience at some point destructive powers in our lives that are bigger than we are. And sometimes, you know, those kinds of things can have a hold on us. And at least for a while, we can't see an escape. We can't see a way out. We can't see hope. And it can be any number of things. It can be a feeling of hopelessness and depression. It can be an addiction. It can be, you know, a feeling of emptiness and aimlessness, or it can be related to something that's happening in our lives, like an illness or someone we love being hurt, or a sense of guilt. So there's a million things that can have us held captive. But eventually, you know, these kinds of things, like in this story, can start to take away the good things in our lives. They can start to break down our relationships. They can start to break down our self-esteem and our health and our community and a sense of direction and purpose in life. So again, we can debate the language about a story like this and what it's talking about, but I think the experience is very real to us. Luckily for us, the gospel story doesn't end with this guy suffering and being held captive to whatever this thing is. Because in this story, not only do we meet this man who's captive, who's suffering, but we also meet Jesus meeting this man who's suffering. And there's this interesting conversation that happens when Jesus confronts the man, and he starts kind of having a conversation with the evil. You know, I am legion. And there's this weird thing where he releases it into the pigs, and I don't have time to talk about that. I don't know if I have the exact answers anyway. But at the end of the day, what we can say is that Jesus releases the man from the thing that's holding him captive. He gives him his life back. He gives this guy the ability to leave the tomb, to lead the things that are taking away his life, and to rejoin community, to rejoin his family, to rejoin life as it's abundant, as it's joyful in this world. And when we're struggling, when we have something that feels like it's holding us captive, isn't this exactly what we would want to see in God? Right? Isn't this that we want? What we want to see? That God cares, that Jesus is with us in our suffering, that he notices us, that God wants to set us free. And often in life, often does set us free. And I know that sometimes the idea of the power of God can seem pie in the sky. That's true even for pastors. You know, there are times where you see a big problem and it's hard to believe that there's going to be any hope in it. But, you know, you also see these situations and you see these stories of hopelessness. And then pretty soon there's hope in them. Things you would have never thought would be possible. You know, one of the privileges of being a pastor is that you get to talk to people who will share their stories of transformation with you. And it's amazing the things that happen. I think about in a previous ministry setting, this fellow who is a wonderful pillar of the church, a tremendously generous guy, just great all around. He shared with me, after I knew him for a little bit, that he had a major issue with alcoholism in his life. And, you know, he was on his second marriage because his alcoholism had torn his life apart. It had alienated him from his first wife and his family. It had messed with a lot of his relationships. And like many, he had hit rock bottom and everything was bad and he was angry. And yet, you know, through his relationship with God and by meeting people in help groups and by being part of a church, he rebuilt his life with God's help. And I think at a certain point, everyone would have looked at him and said, he's hopeless. And yet through God and God's people, he found hope and became this wonderful person. I think also when I was at my last church, I was at a big church and we had this big confirmation program of over 60 kids. And a lot of times we all had fun together. There was a few times where there were some kids who hated it. And there was one girl in particular who would come every week pretty much, but you could just see in her face she did not want to be there. And it got so bad that eventually her parents were meeting with me and saying, you know, she's just so angry and I have to like pull her out the door and she's screaming and yelling. She's just not happy. You know, do we have to bring her to confirmation? And eventually it kind of became this thing where I thought about it too and I thought, you know, if you're literally yanking her out of the door physically, it's probably not worth, you know, that we don't want that to be her image of God, that God is forcing you into a class that you don't want to be in. So let's just let her be and let, you know, there's our grace for this situation. Let her not go to confirmation. And so that was this girl early on in high school. And then a couple years go by and it's the youth gathering time where we go somewhere with 30,000 other youth and adults and have these neat experiences. And surprisingly, this girl who had barely come to church the whole time since that moment where she quit confirmation signs up to go on this youth trip. And she comes along, and she's this whole nother person. And she's working through some stuff, like lots of teenagers are, but she was just like joyous and helpful and excited to be there and experiencing God. And you could see her during worship and stuff, taking something from it. And again, had you gone 3 years back and looked at her, it's like there's no hope. She hates God. She hates the church. She hates their pastor. She hates her family. There's no hope. And yet here was hope coming when it was least expected. And so, you know, I don't want to say that knowing God is a magic bullet for every situation. Sometimes there are difficult things in our lives that having faith isn't going to automatically fix. And there are lots of other kinds of help that we can find beyond just our faith, a professional help that can be helpful when we feel stuck and alone. But I don't think we want to underestimate the power of knowing when we're stuck, when we feel captive, that we are not alone, that we have a God who loves us and wants to set us free, and that we also have God's people who love us and want to set us free. And that is really why we're here together each week. It's to be Christ for each other. You know, so that when we believe in Christ, it's not just an idea or a letter on a page. It is a loving community where we come together and we are the body of Christ together. And that way, when we meet that big, scary monster, when we meet that demon, literal or figurative, in our life that has hold on us, we can remember that the body of Christ is bigger than any demon that we can meet in the world. Amen.